Hi everyone, Richard from Digital Foundry here, and we're going to be taking a look at Gravity Rush 2 running at 4K on the PlayStation 4 Pro. And joining me to discuss the game, John Linneman.
Hi, how's it going, Rich?
Absolutely fantastic. Good to have you back.
Yeah, I guess it's our first video of 2017 together, so It's not a bad game to start with.
Yeah, so I've been holding on to this one for you just to get your take on it. And you've already published your initial analysis, but we didn't actually do a 4K video. So I thought for the 4K users out there that we'd do a native 4K video. And, well, first impressions, John, what do you reckon?
Well, you know what? It looks pretty good overall when played on an actual 4K display. Now, as I mentioned in that initial video, though, I do think that the game is using that geometry upscaling technique. So you get very clean, sharp, native 4K edges on all geometric shapes, you know, edges of objects, but everything internal, everything else is rendered at a lower resolution, presumably 1080p, so within surfaces it looks more lower resolution.
So this is actually fascinating.
It is, yeah.
I didn't really know about it until I met with Mark Cerny, where he was discussing the various upscaling strategies available to developers. And, yeah, I think he called it geometry rendering, where essentially they use the ID buffer to create a full 4K geometry pass. But the actual visual processing, the pixel shaders, everything else is essentially run at native 1080p.
Right.
And it kind of looked a bit weird when I saw it, because I saw Infamous First Light using this native rendering and the checkerboarding technique they eventually used. And it kind of struck me as a bit weird seeing this one. Obviously, when you do a pixel count, it comes out as native 4K.
Right.
But it's very kind of blurry, isn't it?
Yeah, and you know what? I think whether or not you go with this mode will kind of depend upon the artistic design of your game. So, like, Gravity Rush 2 uses it, and Bound also uses this technique, and both of them are very stylized games. So, you kind of have this painterly look to all the textures anyway. So, you know, it doesn't look bad. It just looks, you know, different. I think if you were going for a more realistic-looking game, it would actually look a little bit worse, and maybe checkerboarding would be the better option, though I believe it's still the more expensive option.
Definitely, yeah. Geometry rendering, I was told, has a very low cost.
Yeah.
So
pretty good trick then.
Yeah, so in terms of doing like a fairly basic, easy geometry upscale, I believe it only takes developers a couple of days, whereas checkerboarding can be like 3 or 4 weeks' work to integrate that. So, it's an easy win, I think. And I think you're right, it's going to depend on the quality of the content in terms of, you know, fine, intricate detail. I don't think it would work particularly well there. But we've got this kind of, well, I won't say it's anime, but it's a very stylized look.
Yeah, and you know, it's kind of continuing where they were with the Vita version, though I think they kind of took things even further here. But I think the overall look of the game is quite striking, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's a beautiful game. I haven't actually played the final code. I haven't played it on Pro, but I did play the demo that was released over Christmas.
And I think the key thing for me is, like, to begin with, so on the resolution thing, is that when you're actually playing this on a real 4K TV at a normal distance, it does look, you know, it looks very, very sharp, and it does feel almost like you're actually getting that native 4K, and you can kind of overlook what's happening within the surfaces themselves. It's a pretty cool trick for this game. It really works.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's absolutely fascinating. Very low cost, so you are getting native 4K from the Pro, and it is, you know, a cutting edge title, I think.
While we're at this scene here with this boss fight, I think that also helps point out some of the other strong aspects of the game. So here we see both a lot of physics and huge amounts of post-processing effects, right? I mean, just the way everything swirls around, it really looks convincing, and then they apply that nice object motion blur to everything. So when you splinter a crate and pieces go flying all over the place, it's really accentuated. It looks really nice, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this boss was actually in the demo, and the frame rate was tanking pretty badly there. But the final game, I was watching your video last night, actually, and it looks as though it's not perfect, but it's pretty much there.
Yeah, it's basically a locked 30 frames per second, I'd say. I mean, there, you know, as you can see in that other video, there's a few dips here and there, but really, this was kind of the point I had to get to, which is like episode 7 in the game. It happens right. in a completely different spot than the demo, much later, actually. And up until this point, there really wasn't anything much in the way of drops at all on the Pro or the base PS4. It's very, very stable.
Mm-hmm. What do you think of the technology behind the game itself? Obviously, it's very different to games out there.
It does. It has a really... You know, they obviously had to build an engine that could handle extremely large areas that were both kind of in a different dimension, I suppose, with the whole, like, the gravity system. So, I don't know if you could tell from some of the video here, but they kind of stack the world in a way. Like, you have the very, very upper tier... In the city, you have this middle area here, which is huge, and then you have like the poor slums below, and it's a significant distance between those, and the way they were able to create that world is really impressive, I think. But mm-hmm. you can definitely see the limitations. The level of detail pop in is pretty evident. When you fly over any busy area and you're at a reasonable distance, it's pretty much empty, right? And as you get closer, you start to see all the things like the stalls and the crowds and everything kind of draw in, but it still doesn't look bad, I'd say. Though, I was surprised to see parallax occlusion mapping in this game.
Yeah.
You can't really see it in this shot. Well, maybe hard to say on the textures there on the wood, but especially in the city area, a lot of the tiles and the stones used on the city streets actually use palm, which... doesn't seem like a common thing we see in Japanese games.
mm-hmm. Yeah, I noticed that in the demo. It was really nice to see that sort of effect. And I noticed there we had a pretty extended cutscene there. Was that engine-driven?
Yeah, I wanted to mention this because I didn't get to mention this in the video. So a number of cutscenes can be real-time, but I found that the majority of the big scenes are actually video. And what they did is kind of interesting, because I think it looks kind of sharp when you see it on a real TV, because when they upscale the videos to 4K, they do a nearest neighbor scale, which I've always argued gives you sort of like a crisper pixel detail, though if you look up close, it definitely looks rougher than if you blur it. So it does have a very different look than what you typically get with upscaled videos, and I think it works pretty well, though there's still some noticeable compression artifacts in there as well.
Right, okay, so just to clear up the jargon then, essentially 1080p is quarter 4K resolution.
Correct,
so
yeah.
So one pixel is essentially being quadrupled into four pixels in the upscale to 4K.
Yep, that's exactly right.
Uh-huh, okay. And yeah, you're right, I've noticed that this does give a very sort of crisp look. Sometimes it can look pretty poor, but I think with this type of artistic style, it's probably the best move.
Yeah, I think so. And thinking of examining the artwork, by the way, you see right in this specific moment here, I switched to a first-person point of view,
okay.
which I thought was a pretty cool trick, because you can basically play most of the game, I'd say. Not everything, but just about everything in a first-person viewpoint.
Uh-huh.
And you could see, you know, sometimes it can get a little bit difficult to see what you're doing, but it's very, very neat to be able to examine the world in first person, and it definitely gives it, like, a new sense of scale.
Mm-hmm. I just had a sort of nightmarish vision of playing this in VR.
Oh, man.
That would be insane.
Not a good idea, I'd say.
But, yeah, the first person actually looked really interesting. I hadn't seen that. Is that actually in the demo?
I don't know if it's in the demo, but in the full game, it's literally just you press left on the D-pad,
mm-hmm.
and it just switches to it. And by default, it actually translates the motion, the gyroscope from the controller to camera movement as well. And just kind of the natural movement of your hands while running around gives it this like weird-looking bob that looks mm-hmm. kind of realistic. Oh, and this scene here, by the way, there I am looking at some of the parallax occlusion maps on the ground. Not super high res, I suppose, but I think it looks pretty good here.
Okay, fair enough. And what about the AF?
As the camera looks up a little bit, you can see it's adequate, but mm-hmm. maybe not perfect. And some of the textures like that are a little bit blurry, I'd say. So texture work is kind of hit or miss, but overall it works well with the style, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, I mean, there is traditionally thought to be some sort of cost when you use parallax occlusion mapping.
Yeah.
And high levels of AF, so that might explain that.
Yeah.
But yeah, overall, I was kind of really impressed with the game's visual look, and it's actually really nice to see a Japanese developer sort of pushing the hardware a bit.
Yeah, I definitely agree, and it's just it's very cohesive looking overall. And as I said in the video, I really want to commend them for delivering basically a bug-free, polished experience that runs well on the Pro and takes advantage of it, but also runs well on the base PS4. It's just like you get the game and it just works. It looks great and it runs great, and you can't really expect that with every game these days. And in fact, it's becoming a bit of a rarity, I'm afraid. To get one that's really polished, I mean.
Was there a day one patch on it?
Well, this was a download, so actually, I'm not entirely sure. I'll have to check on that, but I'm pretty sure Pro support is baked into the game since, it shipped late enough, so it shouldn't be a problem.
Yeah, and it kind of has to be these days, according to Sony's guidelines.
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
Plus, you can see right here, you remember that mission from the demo where you had to trail for stolen goods? That's actually right here instead. So they kind of took pieces from the demo and placed them all in different locations. And they kept this. I like these comic book style sequences that they use for some of the more simple transitional cutscenes. Kind of a nice look. Although the artwork itself is still 1080p, since I presume they were designing the game for that resolution originally. So, you know. Yeah. But the text is 4K, which is nice, so it's nice and crispy looking.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it all kind of moves pretty quickly, smoothly. No real noticeable loading screens or anything like that. It just kind of, the game just kind of flows really well.
So we were talking about the demo last night, and it was kind of like you sort of were describing it almost like a sort of greatest hits of stuff that you do in the game.
Yeah, and that's kind of the way.
And you were saying that some of the more boring stuff was just taken out completely.
Yeah, so if we're talking about the game a little bit, I actually like it overall, and I think it plays very well, and there's some extremely cool missions in here that make it worthwhile, but they really lean heavy into a few specific types of gameplay that I don't really like. And this is going to vary from person to person, because I was kind of pushing to cover the game and wanted to make progress. But there's so many times when the game basically says, all right, you get to this point, now go look for an object, a person, or a place. And it gives no indication of where it could be. It's just very fuzzy. Like, you have to look around in this 3D environment that's very abstract, and you can go up and down and everywhere, and you have to find some small object. And I swear, that just, it just puts the brakes on sometimes, where you're just like, man, where the heck am I supposed to go? Like, there's a point where it's like, okay, you get to this island, and it's like, let's play hide and seek here with this guy. And we might see some of that later, but frustrating. And you can see in this scene here, I'm actually going around just showing people like a photo to look for a specific group. And it feels a little bit weird. I don't know. There's something about it that's just a little off. Like, I guess the concept is sound, but you know, it's very busy work, right?
Mm-hmm. It sounds like they're basically sort of giving you something to fill the time as opposed to a constructive task.
Yeah, so it's like, it feels like they maybe padded out the game a little bit. Like, it would have been stronger if they focused more on what the game does best rather than leaning so heavily on these, like, busy work tasks where it's like finding people or getting objects and taking them places. And, I suppose some people may like that, but it definitely took me out of it a little bit. But overall, though, I've had some fun with the main missions, so.
It's really interesting that none of that was in the demo, though.
Yeah, like, look at this. Like, this next scene coming up here. So, I have to trail this guy up here, right? So, I think I do it in first person, even. But it's literally just a follow this guy around for about 10 minutes. So, I'm just walking behind him so that I don't get caught. And he just kind of goes about his business. And you can see, I mean, this is what you do for literally like 10 minutes, and I'm not gonna show the whole thing here because, well, that's absurd. Although, so yeah, and there's also these forced stealth sequences at points, where they kind of like really lock down. They make you go through very specific areas, and everything that's off limits, there's like guards placed that make sure that you get caught immediately. So it becomes sort of a trial and error of, all right, I need to find exactly where to go in this scene. And if you don't find it, you're going to have to retry. And that is also very annoying.
So, yeah, it's a sort of far cry from that sort of incredible boss battle we just had.
Yeah, exactly. Ago. And, you know, it's kind of neat that they switch the tone around, but really the game is at its best, I think, when you're navigating or engaging in combat.
Mm-hmm. Good stuff. So are there plenty more of those bosses in there? Or is that literally the only one
well,
you saw?
I'm currently on, like, sequence 9 or whatever you could say, and I've seen a couple. There's been a couple more bosses. That was one of the bigger ones, but I would imagine there's more than that for sure. Mm-hmm. Since it still seems like I'm quite early in the game, really. Though I will say that the conceit of basically you're a member of that crew on that barge that flies around through the sky, and so you don't start in the city area initially. You're basically excavating for resources, and I think it's kind of cool that you're traveling around on this basically floating group of ships. So there's a nice hook there that the original game didn't actually have, and I can appreciate that. But it's a good excuse to go to all kinds of crazy places.
Good stuff. So tell me, this does have 1080p downsampling support.
Oh yes, that absolutely does. Okay. So obviously that only affects edges of geometry, since, you know, internally, or, you know, in surface is rendered at, I guess, 1080p anyway, so it doesn't really benefit. But if you look along edges, like on the building rooftops here, they definitely look sharper at a distance and cleaner when you downsample to 1080p. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a really interesting technique. I mean, are there still aliasing issues left over, though?
There's a few times where you can see some in-surface aliasing on some structures and whatnot, but I'd say overall it looks very, very clean.
Yeah, is it an improvement over the base?
Definitely, definitely an improvement. Mm. Though the anti-aliasing technique used on the base is pretty good on its own, so even at 1080p it's a very clean-looking title overall, but downsampling from 4K is definitely an improvement.
Well, it's good to see that the option was implemented, because it's been a bit touch and go on various titles recently.
Yeah, two Sony titles even. They removed it from The Last of Us, and The Last Guardian shipped without it, so a little bit strange there.
Yeah, but, well, at least it's good to see that there is, I don't suppose you could have better 1080p support in there unless they wanted to re-divert the resources to producing an unlocked frame rate mode, and typically that hasn't worked. Incredibly
yeah,
well.
I don't think that's necessarily a good idea. I mean, oftentimes that hinges upon the CPU, right? And we know that the Pro didn't really receive a boost enough in that area to really make up the difference. So, you know, I think I just saw the video on Steep, which shipped with the same res as, I guess, the base PS4 version, but it runs with an uncapped frame rate, and it just never gets close to holding 60, not even close. And that's just, for me at least, that's a very unpleasant experience. So I'm kind of okay that they didn't attempt that here.
Yeah, I kind of wish, though, that developers had the ability to switch the console to 50 hertz mode. If your game's running at 50 frames per second, switch the output to 50 hertz. Pretty much every HD TV these days supports all frequencies.
Yeah,
50,
that's absolutely
50,
right.
60. So that would be the way I would do it, but... I don't know. I guess there's maybe worries about compatibility there. I think it's unfounded. But it's kind of like on PC. I've been doing that fairly recently when I want to play a 4K game and I can't get a locked 60. I mean, essentially, if you lock to 50, custom resolution, lock to 50, your GPU requirement drops by, 17%? And
yeah,
you're getting
exactly.
Totally consistent frame times. And it's, you know, you lose 3.3 millisecond per frame, but I can live with that. But, you know, you're right. If you don't have the ability to switch to 50 hertz, then, you know, you're getting a kind of quite a wobbly experience.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely not optimal at all.
Okie doke. So, any final notes on Gravity Rush 2?
Well, I think overall it's a strong package. It looks great. It plays very well. It has some questionable mission design decisions in there, but I do think it's worth supporting. And I do think if you're interested in the game and you enjoyed the demo, you can expect a very, very polished, solid experience, regardless of which PlayStation console you own. And I think that's to be commended.
Good stuff. Well, I think we'll leave it there. Yeah, hope you enjoyed this 4K Let's Play. I hope to do a few more in the future. Do like and subscribe if you'd like to see more of this stuff on Digital Foundry. And remember that you can support us via Patreon to get hold of a pristine quality 4K download. That's all we got for now. Thanks a lot for that, John.
Thank you. Have a good one.
Catch you next time.